Hey y'all, this is the Dr. Nurse with thedrnurse.com, and today we're going to be talking about one of my favorite subjects, EKG interpretation. So I have 10 easy steps to interpret your EKG rhythm, and we're going to talk about each one of those today. Number one is know your measurements. Number two, we're going to count the rate. Number three, is the rhythm regular? Number four, what does our P wave look like, and is there a P wave for every complex? Number five and number six, this is where it gets hairy. But with number five, we're gonna measure the PR interval. With number six, we're gonna measure the QRS interval. Number seven, we're gonna look at the ST segment because that's important to make sure your patient's not having any ischemia. Number eight, we're gonna look at the T wave. And number nine, we're gonna measure the QT interval. And then number 10 is just to interpret the strip. Okay, so number one, know your measurements. With your 6-second strip, you're going to have an EKG, what I call a grid, and the grid is going to be broken up into these big boxes and the smaller boxes. All right, and so every small box like this is going to be a measurement of 0.04 seconds. Okay, so these are measured in seconds. So remember, small box, 0.04. Every big box, the big box is going to be 0.20 seconds. So remember, your small box are 0.04, big boxes 0.20. All right, so number two, count the rate. This is easy, y'all. Every EKG strip that you're gonna look at or that you're gonna interpret is gonna have these lines up here at the top. And to measure out a 6-second strip is going to be in between, what's in between three of these lines up at the top of your EKG paper. So in between these three lines is a 6-second strip. So you count your complexes in between the 6 seconds and then multiply that times 10. Here I have three complexes in between my 6-second strip. So multiply that times 10, and I've got a rate of 30. So this patient is very bradycardic, but I had to make them big so y'all could see them. All right, so the measurements, the rate, and then number three is the rhythm regular. And the easiest way to figure out if your rhythm is regular, I did this in school. I did it as a nurse. I wouldn't get out my calipers. I would just get a piece of paper, and you mark your R to R complexes on your paper. I don't know if y'all can see that. And then you just go down the line and measure if the distance in between every complex is regular. And we're just gonna say that this one is, okay? If you have somebody that's in AFib or something like that, nothing is going to march out. It's going to be all over the place. It'll be very obviously irregular. So then if it's, we've looked at the measurements, counting the rate, and we've looked at if the rhythm is regular or not. The next thing is to look at your P wave. So what you're looking for with your P wave is, number one, is there a P wave? Okay, is there a P wave for every single complex? This is the P wave. You want there to be a P wave for every single complex, right? Because your P wave represents atrial depolarization. If there is a P wave for every single complex, if it is upright and normally shaped, that means that your complex, your beat is initiating from the SA node. That's where it's supposed to be coming from, right? So your P wave being upright and present with every single complex gives you the right to call this a sinus rhythm, because that means every complex is being initiated by the sinus node, okay? Number five, we're gonna measure the PR interval. And for the measurement part, I'm going to use this middle complex here because that was the one that I got to actually fall correctly on the little boxes. So the PR interval, I've always said, why don't we call this the PQ interval? But nonetheless, to measure your PR interval, you're gonna start from the beginning of the P wave, so where the P wave starts to leave that isoelectric line, to the beginning of your Q wave, okay? And you're going to count the number of boxes, All right, so for this middle complex here, our PR interval is actually, it starts here and ends here. So it's really just one small box. So our PR interval here would be 0.04 seconds because it's just one box. And that's actually really, really small, but like I said, I had to make the complexes big so you could see them. We want our PR interval to be shorter than 0.20 seconds, okay? Because if our PR interval is longer than 0.20 seconds, it's a first degree AV block, all right? And number six, we're going to measure the QRS interval. So with measuring the QRS, you want to start here where the Q starts to leave the baseline, and you want to stop counting here where the S wave, where it returns to the baseline. And so this one would be about one box length, one small box, and one small box is 0.04 seconds. So that's well within our parameters. Any QRS interval that is longer than 0.12 seconds, which would be three small boxes, that would indicate that there is a bundle branch block, meaning that there is a problem with conduction through the bundle branches, a problem with electrical conduction. That doesn't mean that there's a physical blockage. Okay, number seven, we're going to look at the ST segment. So that's just the short little segment in between where the S wave comes back up here to the isoelectric line to where the T wave starts to leave it. And if it is depressed or elevated, then that's going to indicate ischemia or infarction. Okay, so our ST segment here is great, no problems. The next thing we're going to look at is the T wave itself. Okay, just like with the P wave, we want to make sure that there's a T wave for every complex, that it's upright, because what we call an inverted T wave is going to indicate some ischemia going on with your patient. Okay, so for this patient who's in a sinus bradycardia, we've established there is a T wave for every complex and it is upright, so he's good. And so the last thing you're going to measure, and a lot of times this isn't taught in school, but it's important, is the QT interval. So the QT interval is measured starting right here where your Q wave starts to leave the isoelectric line all the way to here where your T wave returns. Okay, this represents the entire time that it takes the ventricles to depolarize and repolarize. Okay, so a very long, or what we call a prolonged QT interval, can leave your patient open to lots of deadly dysrhythmias. All right, so we want that QT interval to not be any longer than 0.50 seconds, okay? So you wanna measure, like I said, starting here where your Q wave leaves, all the way to the end where your T wave comes back to the baseline. No longer than 0.50 seconds, because a prolonged QT can open your patient up for V-fib and other kind of dysrhythmias that we don't want. All right, so just real quick recap. Number one, know your measurements. Small boxes, big boxes. Number two, count the rate. In between three lines up at the top of your grid, multiply that times 10. Number three, is the rhythm regular? Get your piece of paper out and measure from complex to complex. Is it the same amount of distance? Number four, do you have a P wave for every complex, and is it upright and regular looking? Number five, measure the PR interval. So your PR interval starts here where your P wave starts to leave the baseline, all the way to where your Q wave starts to leave the baseline. And so this PR interval right here is one box, which measures 0.04 seconds, well within our limit of under 0.20 seconds. Number six, we're going to measure the QRS interval, which starts here where the Q starts to leave the baseline to where it returns to the baseline here. So It is one box on this complex, 0.04 seconds. It's less than the 0.12 that we want to see. You look at the ST segment right here. Is it depressed or elevated? You look at the T wave. Is there a T wave for every complex? And is it upright? Because an inverted T wave could mean ischemia. And then number 9, you're going to measure the QT interval all the way from the beginning of the Q wave to where the T wave returns to the baseline. And we want that less than 0.50 seconds. And this has just been a real quick overview of EKG interpretation. You can go to the site, www.thedoctornurse.com, and there are little cheat sheets and things like that to help you with EKG interpretation. I hope you have found this video helpful, and thanks for watching.